suggested to me or told me that, the direct line of reporting would be that I would become responsible for the Parks and Recreation Department among the other departments that report directly to me. Not long thereafter, much to my surprise, candidly, several employees came forward to Mr. Breed and asked if they could speak with him regarding concerns that they had, and these were employees of the Parks and Recreation Department, and concerns that they had regarding the department and, the leadership in the department. One response to the that discussion, which Mr. Breed asked me to be involved in, he and I jointly decided that we needed to know more about the overall operation of the department and the individuals that were involved in that operation and had accepted the responsibilities of making the, programs and projects of the Parks and Recreation Department work. We talked about how to do that, Mr. Breed and I, and both of us, from our past experiences, had some thoughts and ideas. Mr. Breed suggested that he had engaged what we both called an employee assessment in some previous work here within the county, and if I'm not mistaken, I believe specifically within the, building codes department. I mean, it's not. Our intention was to determine, try to help get a sense of the strengths and weaknesses of the department as seen by the leadership in the department, and to help determine areas where we could engage some improvements and implement any operational changes that might be associated with the department now reporting to me essentially, and the, commission no longer being in place. It was also an opportunity for us to, know these people we had not worked directly with, and it was a, chance of them for them to give us their perspective of how the department was operating. As Mr. Caton said, we did notify Mr. Caton as a director of the department of the, persons that we wished to talk to, a cross-section of the department leadership, and we scheduled actually 15 appointments to engage in those discussions. We try to be careful to follow a set line of questioning in that, we wanted each of these individuals to have an opportunity to discuss with us, but we wanted to be sure that, each of them had the same line of questions, or almost the same exact questions, if you will. We actually ended up adding one, so we interviewed 16 of the Parks and Recreation Department employees. And unfortunately, we found with that those interviews a, common theme regarding the director, Mr. Caton. And that those common themes were, of course, very concerning to us. They included not listening to employees, being very controlling, displaying poor leadership and poor communication, at points being combative with employees and community partners, and creating a negative or hostile work environment. The, employees, not just majority, but unanimously, indicated that they felt that they were not being heard and that they didn't really matter. And that the only thing that mattered in the Parks and Recreation Department was the opinions of Mr. Caton and, what he wanted to do. So then our concern was how do we move forward from this? And, we determined that instead of waiting any longer or making any further efforts to encourage change, that the best change to take place was a change in leadership. And obviously, with that change in leadership, it led us to inform Mr. Caton that he was being dismissed. As we looked at county policy, as you're aware of policy 10.6 regarding dismissal of county co-workers, there was not one specific factor within that policy that resulted in termination, but a whole process there. The policy talks about that the list that you have there is not totally inclusive of all the grounds, but it's intended to give a guide. And Mr. Reed and I looked at that for a guide. We determined that Jeff Caton was engaging in conduct that reflected unfavorably to the county as an employer and was offensive to both the general public and his fellow employees. Fair or not, department directors are held to a special duty and they accept their role as being a department director any organization, in particular with this county. And that duty is to better those that work with them and to also be the point of contact with the public in creating a positive image and an effort of cooperation and providing exemplary public service. We determined that there was not a positive image. And we also determined, even in the afternoon of this discussion that we had with Jeff, that he failed to acknowledge any shortcoming at all. And as you heard, expressed to us his disdain for the process. We did try to summarize our reasons for dismissal to Mr. Caton. And of course, he has received a letter from Mr. Green that outlines that. The decision was not one that, when Reed took lightly, was not one that I took lightly. As you heard, it was not one that Jeff Caton takes lightly. Jeff has indeed been with the county for a number of years, but he had been discussed with him that some things needed to change, and his approach to leadership in a bad position needed to change, and indeed that his job was in jeopardy. And Jeff either could not or would not acknowledge that there were any problems, and therefore, in our view, made no effort to address them. And that led us to determining that the leadership was necessary. I'll be glad to try to answer any questions you have.
Hey, Mr. Hill. Were you present when Caton was terminated?
Yes, sir, I was.
And in our package that we had, and correct me in saying this, is that his termination was not due to anything that had to do with the Cleveland Park incident or the other members of council or anything else?
No, sir, it was not.
Warnings, reprimand, anything?
I'm not aware of any. I know there were just conversations with Mr. Reed and Mr. Caton beginning, as I said, somewhere in the winter. I have not seen anything written from those conversations.
Okay.
Mr. Gibbs, you may proceed.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Caton, if you will, if you like, you have response to what Mr. Gibbs said.
Yes, sir. I will clarify a few things. First of all, the meetings that Mr. Gibbs spoke to did not begin until April. They did not happen in the wintertime. They happened starting in April, and I have documentation of that, where we discussed issues of perceived concerns of the agency that were brought on by media attention surrounding both the train accident as well as issues surrounding the council's, I hate to keep using the word attack, but council's address of the commission. And because that was played out so publicly, the concern that Mr. Breed expressed to me in those meetings was that we needed to do something to change the image. And I exchanged back with Glenn that I have a very difficult time changing the image of the agency when they're constantly under attack by council. That was the discussion that we had. We did not have winter meetings, as I've shared before. The issues that I had, the discussions that I had with Glenn started in April and followed into May. I think we had three meetings in May. I have those documented, where we had the same discussions. There were never any specific recommendations provided for me to do to move forward to be able to change the image or what have you. So those meetings did not occur, and that discussion did not occur until April timeframe. What I will also remind you of is the statement that I made, that those employee conversations were precipitated by a canvassing of staff that then approached Mr. Hip at the time and shared with him negative comments. And I have received information from a number of sources that that was done in exchange for benefit, and that those benefits have actually been realized already to date by several employees. What I will tell you, and I'm going to go back to what I initially started with in the issue of due process here, that it's almost impossible for y'all to determine the truth of two competing versions of my termination. Almost impossible. The only way to do it is to permit both sides to call witnesses and to compel the attendance of those witnesses subject to the control of the county. For those county employees, Mr. Hip says that unanimously that all of our staff had issues with me, that I'd like to have the opportunity to question and ask if that's really true or if that's just Mr. Hip's word in this case. You have no way of knowing that unless those witnesses are compelled to be here. You have an opportunity to table the decision that you have in front of you and schedule another hearing at which these witnesses can be called and questioned. This is your choice that you can make. But I affirm to you right now that I have facts on my side, and that without the ability to confront those people and to get this proof out in front of you to be able to make that decision, it makes your task impossible to come to a resolution, because obviously we have two different viewpoints that we're sharing with you today. I have documentation. I don't believe Mr. Hip has much documentation. Those meetings did not happen prior to April. We had a meeting with the livability committee in March. And beyond that, there were no discussions about leadership issues or commission issues or anything of that nature. And the record reflects that when you look at council meeting minutes and look at all the other documentation that was provided to council, that this issue was an issue.